Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore, from the rising of the sun to its going down. The Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, His glory above the heavens. And Lord, we just bow in your presence this morning, thankful for your love for us, appreciative of the many, many ways you bless our lives, excited to worship you, anxious to give the sacrifice of praise, to participate in this wonderful time of just family gathering, praising your holy name. Lord, I pray that you'd meet with us today. I pray that you would move powerfully in our midst. I pray that you'd open our hearts, open our minds to what you have for us today. Lord, I pray that every man, woman, teenager, boy, and girl today would just lay it all down at the altar, lay it down at your feet, giving you our hearts, our lives, our families, our church. Lord, it's all yours. So today we just want to bow down before you and give you the honor and glory that you deserve. And we do ask, Lord, that you touch our lives. Help us to know that you are with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue singing.
Thank you. He washed it white as snow. exalted.
Should I tithe from my net or my gross paycheck?
If I tithe 15%, will you help me find a wife?
I'm sure my husband gave some last week.
I'll tithe next week.
Gee, I wonder how much money the church is wasting on these little envelopes.
You can have it, but I want you to know I'm not happy about it.
I made all those cookies for Kids Smoker. God's really not going to miss my money.
Who really cares if I tithe from my bonus?
Once my taxes are all paid.
After my credit cards.
Once my car's paid off.
Once my loans are paid off, then I'll tithe.
I'll start giving again.
Then I can tithe.
Then I can tithe.
I have so little to give.
If the game starts at 1:15 and we leave church by 12:30, we can grab lunch and have 15 minutes to make it home.
I wonder if I left the iron
on. I love you, God.
I love you, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
I love you, God.
I love you, God.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord. I love you, God.
I love you.
This is the time of the service where normally, if you're used to business as usual at Kingsland, we collect tithes and offerings. We're going to put that off for a few minutes. And today, our focus subject is on the topic of giving. That's what we're going to talk about. So we'll take our offering in just a few minutes. But there's a few things I want to say to you from my heart that I believe the Lord has led me to deal with today. Now, for some of you, this will be brand new and will seem a little bit strange. For others of you, you will think, boy, why do they do this every week? It seems like every week they're talking about this subject. Well, that's not true. Every week we give you an opportunity to give, but the truth is it's been since July that I gave a message specifically on this subject. You might remember that because we wrote down, anybody in the church that had needs, they wrote down their list of needs, and then we met those needs. Do you remember that? It was an awesome thing. That's about the time we started our benevolence fund for family members, church family members who were in need to help them. And boy, in these times, what a wonderful thing to have at our disposal, the ability to help people in our family who are in financial need. Found out about another church member just this week who lost their job. That's a difficult thing. If you've never been through that, I'm sure for most of us, that's just a nightmare to even think about, losing your job. Well, it's happening to people all the time. So this subject is, I come to you with some fear and trepidation because, boy, you know, in hard times, we're in recession, they say. Well, you could title this talk, How to Recession-Proof Your Life. How to Recession-Proof Your Life. I've entitled it, Just Giving What You Should. Giving What You Should, or giving sacrificially. Imagine if you gave your son or daughter, when they turned old enough to get their license, which isn't 16 anymore, right? It's like 16 in 3 weeks and 2 days or something. But imagine you gave them a brand spanking new car. Just threw them the keys and said, there you go, have at it, have fun. And then imagine if you asked if you could borrow their car. And they said, no, no, you can't have it. Imagine if you took your children out to eat, and I don't have to think very far to think about this, taking the kids somewhere and reaching over to grab one of their little pieces of food, whatever it may be, only to feel, smack, stay off my food, Daddy. That's my food. Keep your fingers out of it. Wouldn't feel very good, would it? One of my favorite tithing stories, I probably tell it every time. Some of you could tell the story, but I love it. I don't care. It's about the little girl whose daddy gave her 2 silver dollars. One for her, one for church. And he gave her those silver dollars and she went skipping her way off to church. And unfortunately, one fell out of her purse and down the drain. And she looked at it going down there and she couldn't reach it. And she said, well, Lord, there goes your dollar. That's how we are sometimes, isn't it? It's sad, but that's how we are. That's how human beings are. And children sometimes seem so selfish, but really, we all tend to be selfish. I want to make a confession to you this morning. I do not have the gift of giving. I have spiritual gifts, and so do you. Some of you have the spiritual gift of giving. You don't have to be rich to have the gift of giving. I know a guy who has not that much money, but I know that he has the gift of giving, just talking to him. I know others that have a lot that don't. I don't have the gift of giving. You don't have to have the gift of giving to give. You don't have to have that spiritual gift. If you do have the gift of giving, boy, money's always on your mind and you always want to give. You may even be obsessed with it. Turn over to Luke chapter 6. If you have the gift of giving, you're going to love this, man. You're just going to eat this up. For the rest of us, you might have to endure a little bit of it. You see, God sees when you give sacrificially, and He blesses it. That's the whole principle. There aren't very, you know, that's the whole thrust of what I'm going to try to say this morning. God sees when you give sacrificially of your time to help somebody, maybe to be a big brother, a big sister, or a mentor, of your resources, of your stuff, of your energy. It takes energy to help another person. It takes hard work, of your money, of your tithes, your offerings, your talents, your skills. When you give of yourself, it's a sacrifice, isn't it? God sees it and God blesses it every single time. Now look at this passage in Luke chapter 6. Look at verse 27, because the grand finale is all the way at the end of verse 38, but the setup for it is so cool, the way God just draws us in and He shows us it's all about your heart. It's not about dollars and cents. It's about your heart. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. Verse 28, bless those who curse you and pray for those who spitefully use you. To him who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other also. And from him who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who asks of you, and from him who takes away your goods, do not ask them back. And just as you want men to do to you, you also do to them likewise. But if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do not, and if you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you hope to receive back, what credit is that to you? For even sinners lend to sinners and receive as much back. But love your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you will be the sons of the Most High, for He is kind to the unthankful and evil. Did you see that? God is kind, even to the unthankful and evil. Therefore, be merciful, just as your Father also is merciful. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and it will be forgiven. And then here we go. Check it out. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will it be put into your bosom. For with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Can you just say hallelujah? Hallelujah. When you give, God sees it, and He blesses it every single time. And in this passage, we see that Jesus, and if you had time to read all of Luke 6, and I recommend you do, Jesus heals on the Sabbath. He works on the Sabbath just to get the Pharisees really, really irritated with Him. And then He gives the Beatitudes. It'd do well for you to read those. And that's an attitude thing. That's an inner heart type thing. But in these verses, He shares a variety of timeless kingdom principles with His disciples that we'll discuss today. He specifically mentions giving or lending four times in the text that we just read. Jesus talked more about money than He did anything else. Some people say, well, that's all they're... Don't go to church, they're going to talk about money. Well, they should. If they're a Bible-preaching church, they believe the Bible and they believe what Jesus did, they should. Of course, the funny thing is you never hear anybody saying that about going to a ball game. Don't go to the ball game. They're going to want money. They're going to want a ticket to get in there. When's the last time you went out to eat and complained with your wife the whole way there? They better not ask for money. They had better not ask for money at the end of that meal. I am tired of it. We're very hypocritical, aren't we? When we get physical food, we expect to pay for it. But when we get spiritual food, well, that's different. Maybe not. Maybe it shouldn't be that way. This text gives us five giving admonitions that I want to share with you very quickly. We don't have PowerPoint. We don't have sermon notes. You're just going to have to keep up on your own there. I was afraid if I wrote anything down, people wouldn't come today. Five giving admonitions. Number one, love others regardless of how they treat you. Giving is from your heart. You can put money in the plate and have a rotten attitude. Do you really think God's impressed with that? You can give a bum on the street money and judge him and look down on him as you walk away. Do you think God's impressed with that? Of course not. Love others regardless of how they treat you. Look back at verse 27. I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you. Verse 32 and to 34 say the same basic thing, that we are to love those who don't love us back. If you're not giving from a heart of love and faith, then you're just going through the motions. Don't just go through the motions. And can I confess again? Sometimes I go through the motions. Sometimes I feel like I'm preaching to myself, especially since I don't have the gift of giving. Fortunately, I have a wife who is very meticulous and keeps things up to date for us. Keeps me straight. But when we do our offering in a little bit, most of us are ready to do that. You are all excited. You're ready to throw it in, weren't you? But you ever just take time to think about it and pray over it? and ask God to use it and to bless it and for God to meet your needs and to meet the needs of those that the church is ministering to? It's your heart. It's a heart of love. You know, I feel very guilty. I've had a bad attitude about something. Just in a meeting the other night, we were talking about taking in a collection to help the people in Haiti. And we're going to talk about that next Sunday night. We'll do that. But, you know, the first thing that came out of my mouth, because sometimes I even don't think real spiritual-like, I said, you know what? Until they release those 10 missionaries, I don't think we should give them a dime. Maybe I was right. I don't know. At the time, it seemed right. But whether or not and they've released 8 of them so far, but whether or not they release those missionaries, the corrupt government was corrupt before the earthquake happened. It'll probably be corrupt after it happens. Ladies and gentlemen, we should give to help the needs of people. Do you realize how many of our missionaries are in lands where they would be killed just for trying to share the gospel overtly? They can't even say where they're going. They can't put their name down on anything where they could be tracked because they could get killed for their faith. If we're only going to share the gospel with people who like us and treat us nice, well, we're going to be in trouble, aren't we? The whole world out there that hates the gospel, that hates what we stand for, and we should love them anyway. Love others regardless of how they treat you. They might even throw you in jail. They might throw us in jail for standing for the truth of the Word of God. Are you willing to go? Are you ready to go? I saw a Catholic priest preaching. Man, was he preaching. Wish I could remember his name. But man, he was preaching and he was talking, we will not surrender when it comes to moral issues, when it comes to the sanctity of marriage, when it comes to the unborn. We will not surrender. And I thought, man, where is that guy in these Baptist churches that won't say a word about it? And he spoke the truth in love, by the way. Doesn't mean I agree with everything he believes, obviously. But he was taking a stand on issues in love. And he didn't care what anybody thought about it. He cared about what Jesus Christ thought about it. As should we. We should love others regardless of how they treat us. We should be willing to die for our faith, to turn the other cheek. Number 2, sacrifice to help those in need. That's the message of verse 30. Give to everyone who asks of you. I like giving to people who don't ask more. But sometimes people do ask. Sacrifice to help them. You may have mechanical skills and you can fix their car or construction kit skills. You can help them fix their home. Decorating skills. Not real high on my gifts list there. But it might be on yours. Money, clothes, food, childcare, computers. Well, we're getting ready for Operation Chesterfield, and you can sign up in the back on your way out. Dozens of people already have. You're going to use your skills to minister to other people. We're going to pray tonight at 6:30 for Operation Chesterfield. Come back. Sacrifice your time tonight to do the groundwork ahead of time, the work that needs to be done, the work of prayer. And by the way, we have a lady who wants to lead our prayer team. Praise God. We will have a prayer team you can sign up for in addition to all those other teams. Number 3, obey the golden rule. Do you see that in verse 31? Just do, and just as you want men to do to you, you also do likewise. You know, if we always treated others the way we expect to be treated, the way we assume we should be treated, the world would be a lot better place, wouldn't it? If you treated everybody, check this out, if you treated everybody the way you deserve to be treated at that restaurant, because you think you're King Tut when you sit down at a meal and you're bossing her back and forth, and if you treated everybody the way you expect that server to treat you, man, the world would be a much better place, wouldn't it? Obey the golden rule. Number 4, share, expecting nothing in return. Look back at verse 35. But love your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return. Don't you love that? As parents, we do this. Because you know, you have to make them say thank you, don't you? I bought my son a sword. David, plastic. A sword and a helmet. I bought him the armor of the Lord, okay? And he loves it. He can't get enough of it. But so far all I've got is stabbed by the sword, kicked in the shins, and he bit me the other day. That's true. We give expecting nothing in return to our children. But what if we looked at this society and said, let's give expecting nothing in return from them? Proverbs 19:17. Write that down. Proverbs 19:17. He who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord, and He will pay him back what he's given. Now, is that a promise you can count on or not? He who has pity on the poor, and there's a lot worse things than being financially poor. There's a lot of people that are spiritually poor. And when you have pity on them, man, God sees that. And when you have pity on someone financially that needs help, God will pay you back what you've given. Number five, moving quickly. In verse 37, you see this. Display a gracious attitude. Now, this shouldn't need to be mentioned in church. Of course, most of us have a pretty good attitude at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. But this is talking 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with your wife, with your kids, with the dude asking for money on the street, with your friend that might need help, with your church people, with people you disagree with people you agree with, whatever. Display a good attitude, a gracious attitude. Don't prejudge. When I was in sales, boy, they taught me that. Don't prejudge. You don't know who's going to buy. Give the same spiel to everybody. Any of y'all that are in sales know that, don't you? You don't prejudge. Don't condemn. Remember that God hates sin, but He loves sinners. And so should you. Can we remember that today? God hates sin, and so should you. But God loves sinners, and so should you. And what are you doing in practical ways to really show that? What are you doing in practical ways? I had an opportunity to perform a wedding last night for Laura and Jacob. And I said, you know, love her in practical ways, Jacob. Any husband that doesn't do that is going to have a hard time. Respect him in practical ways. Show him that. Don't just say it. Live it. That's how we should, in that attitude, even in our own marriages, some of which are falling apart because people don't know how to display a good attitude with one another. We've lost our graciousness. We judge one another. We condemn one another. We forget to forgive and be forgiven, just like verse 37 tells us to do. So those are some admonitions concerning giving. But really, it all leads up to verse 38. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will it be put into your bosom. For with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Isn't that a powerful verse? That's either true or it's not. That's either a timeless kingdom principle or it's not. I believe it is. Very true. See, God sees when you give sacrificially of your time and your resources and your energy and your talents and your possessions. He sees when you give your tithe. He sees when you give above and beyond the tithe. And He promises to always bless your sacrifice. If you're a giver, God is going to see that you get everything you need. If you're a taker, I promise you, you will always need more. You will always be taking. Some dude that has everything he needs because he's a giver is going to have plenty to give extra to you because you're a taker. And you're going to constantly need to take and take and take, and you'll never have enough. If you give God a little, God will give you back a little more. If you give God generously, God will bless you generously. He makes the offer. He makes the promise right here. And He waits for you to take the step of faith, believing Him and receiving from His rewards. You either trust Him or you don't. If you trust Him here, He's going to bless you. Richly, you give a little, He'll give you a little more. You give a lot, He'll give you a lot more. Now, this is not some sort of sales pitch. This is not some sort of get-rich-quick scheme. We don't give to get, do we? Or if we do give to get, we give to get so that we can give more. That can get confusing, but you know what I'm trying to say. Let's go to Malachi. Malachi chapter 3. Let's talk about specifically the subject of tithing. Malachi. Let's go Old Testament on you here. Old Covenant. The Old Law. Malachi chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3, and that's a big word, Malachi. Oh my goodness, where's Malachi? Just go to Matthew and go left. It's the last book of the Old Testament. Go to Matthew and go left. You'll be there. The subheading in my Bible says, do not rob God. Well, that'll preach, right? You know, stick them up. Don't rob God. Not a problem, right? It shouldn't be a problem. Well, maybe it is a problem. Let's look. Look at verse 8. Will a man rob God? Malachi 3, verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me. Even this whole nation. What nation? The nation of Israel. Did they have one tithe? No, they had several tithes. They had at least two tithes, plus a tithe every 3 years. This was tied into their theocratic system. This was tied into their taxes. This is a pretty complicated deal, folks. This isn't as straightforward as some folks would like to make it seem. This is an admonition given to the people of Israel. And they were in captivity because they violated God's law in a variety of areas, including the tithe. Their priests were out farming because their priests couldn't work in the temple because they had to go make a living because the people weren't tithing. So we take principles from these lessons that we see here, and we translate them over into our culture here in 2010 the best we can. Look at verse 10. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit on your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. In this text, God promises His people, Israel, that He would abundantly bless them financially and materially if they were wise enough to simply tithe. As New Testament believers, mostly Gentiles, how do we interpret that? Well, I believe that God blesses our tithes, sacrificed for His work. I believe that firmly. In Luke 11:42, Jesus endorses the tithe when He says this to the Pharisees. Woe to you, Pharisees, for you tithe the mint and rue and all manner of herbs and pass by justice and the love of God. In other words, they were tithing off every little thing legalistically. And He said, what are you doing? You tithe off the herbs. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. So they forgot about justice and love. They passed by that. So Jesus says, yes, you should have tithed, but you shouldn't have passed by justice and love. It's all about your heart, isn't it? Anyone who tests God in this regard finds out that God is always faithful. In Scripture, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament, I believe the tithe is a starting point for giving. Now, if you're a guest today, boy, did you pick a funny one to come to. Maybe you're turning into the radio for the first time, or the television ministry. I would like to give you my heartfelt, sincere advice, and that is this. I encourage you to join a Bible-preaching church and tithe. It's been estimated that if every church member in America were to lose their job and go on to public assistance and tithe off that minimal sum, that the offerings and the revenue in churches would go up by 30%. Think about that. How sad. If every member of every church tithe, we could quadruple our missions efforts, our outreach efforts, our staff, our property, all of it. I'd like to share my personal testimony with you, and I shudder to do that because by no means am I the ultimate example, really in any area. But in this area, it's very personal to me. Tithing is something I was taught from the time I was a child. My wife was taught as a child. But I can honestly tell you this morning, tithing is a sacrifice for me and my family. I believe tithes, offerings, sacrifices, all the same thing, okay? It is a major sacrifice. I'm sure those of you that have tithed for 30 years probably could have paid your house off a lot quicker if you hadn't. Maybe. Probably a lot of different ways to look at that. There's a lot of toys and gizmos you could buy if you didn't tithe. For my wife and family, it's a sacrifice. But it's a sacrifice that's worth making. I want to share some reasons with you for why that is, if I may. First reason. I sincerely believe this is my obligation for the kingdom work in my local church. The Old Testament command to tithe carries into a New Testament principle of tithing. 10% is our starting point, but we are free in Christ to do far more. If you're a believer that the Old Testament tithe is an archaic, legalistic stipulation, then you have liberty to do far more than 10%, but never less. You remember the craft building down the road over there by the airport? J.L. Kraft of Kraft Cheese. He tithed 25% of his income. And he said this. He said, the only investment I've ever made that gave consistently increasing dividends is the money that I gave to the Lord. J.D. Rockefeller said, I never would have been able to tithe from my first $1 million, or I never could have been able to tithe from the first $1 million I made if I hadn't tithed on my first salary, which was $1.50 a week. J.C. Penney lived on 10% of his income and tithed 90%. Finance experts, both secular and more religious in nature, encourage tithing, or at least giving charitably. Crown Financial Concepts, Larry Burkett, who's passed away, but his group, Dave Ramsey, Zig Ziglar, teaches this. Even secular business experts encourage tithing. And I personally believe, as for me and my house, we will tithe. It's my obligation for kingdom work in my local church. Second reason I tithe, I can't afford not to tithe. I believe that wholeheartedly. I just can't afford not to. God has been so good to me and my family for too long. I've put Him to the test for more than 30 years. And He's proven faithful to me time and time and time again. Third reason, I know that the tithe is the best money I spend. My tithe is the best money I spend each month. When I die, I'm going to look back at a lot of purchases and go, oh man, what was I thinking? That was an impulse buying decision right there. You know, we've all been there. I'll probably grieve at the way I wasted money. But I'll look at the money I sent ahead through tithing and rejoice for all the good that it did for eternity. Fourth reason, I tithe. I'm becoming more and more aware of the fact that God owns everything I have. I'm becoming more and more aware of the fact that everything I have belongs to God. It's easy to give back 10% when you really honestly believe 100% of it is His. This suit is God's. These shoes I'm wearing are God's. My home belongs to God in the bank. My cars belong to God. My kids belong to God. They're not mine. They're His. This church belongs to God. Everything we have is His. Let me ask you a question. What if everyone gave the way you give? How would we be doing? How would we be doing? Some of you have tithed for so long, it's just automatic. And I want to encourage you to think about it and pray over it. That's why we made the whole deal to revolve around it today. We have some faithful givers in this church. Thank God for you. Keep on giving, but don't get legalistic with it and don't get stuck in a rut and don't get matter of fact about it. Pray over that offering. So what's Kingsland going to do with all this money, by the way? If everybody started tithing, our budget would quadruple instantly. If every member of our church began tithing, our budget would go off the charts. So what are we going to do with all this money? Well, there's some countless examples I can give you of what we do with the resources that God brings in here. But I just want to share five very quickly before we close. Because we're accountable. We're a family. We're a team. And there are people, good people, that pray over. Just Wednesday night, we prayed over what to do with our finances. We want to be wise investors for what God's given. So let me just share five very brief examples. Number one, something called the cooperative program. And you can add in our Annie Armstrong offering next month, Lottie Moon. We're talking over $100,000 or nearly $100,000 that our people have invested into seminaries, missionaries, Southern Baptist efforts, defending our religious liberties, funding the Find It Here campaign that we're going to have next month with the North American Mission Board to tell this community Jesus loves you and to put commercials on television and all that. The cooperative program. Secondly, our radio, television, internet ministry. That's a big one. Probably in the realm of $10,000 or more dollars, making this message available. What you're hearing right now is available all over Richmond. Over 1 million people that can hear this message and through the internet all over the world. We estimate that about 5,000 people in Metro Richmond hear our service every single week through American Family Radio and through Comcast 17 and Fios Channel 27. It's a big deal. Number three, through our children's programs, our Children's Bible Study Fellowship, our Awana, Contenders, Keepers, Kids Zone, Upward, the youth program. You're talking, my goodness, probably $25,000, $30,000 spent, or better said, invested, reaching children all over the community. We send out two vans and a bus every Wednesday night to pick up kids and to bring them here to tell them about Jesus. I assure you, your money's being well spent. God's money, your tithe, is being well spent. How about Operation Chesterfield? Our block party, our Easter services, the one in the fall that we'll do. We're investing more than $10,000 reaching out to families in our community with the gospel. Actually, a lot more than that. We raised that budget, even though most other things didn't, because we're that committed to whether it's mass mailing or television or whatever, door-to-door, flea market, however we can to reach people with God's love. It actually feels very comfortable in here right now. You wouldn't know. I'm very comfortable. Maybe you're freezing. I don't know. But you may not know that we are in need of a new heat and air unit in this worship center. It's going to cost us over $21,000 to get that done, to make our worship center more comfortable. That's a big deal. That's on us right now. We will spend about $50,000, if you add up over the last couple years, with the 7-year plan, doing the interior and the exterior revitalizations, just getting started. So the application to all that is very straightforward. Give. Not just because of the need at Kingsland, but because you want to be obedient and you want your family to be blessed. I want to close now. And would you write down Exodus 35 and 36? In fact, turn to Exodus 35 and 36. I'll be very quick. We won't read all of it. But I want to remind you of what Moses did. This inspired me this week. I felt strongly led of the Lord that this is what we needed to do. Before we go out and invite the entire community to come to our church next month, I really wanted to deal with this subject of giving. And in my personal time with the Lord brought me to this passage. Coincidentally, on the very day that I was going to be building a sermon on the subject of giving, in my quiet time, here is what I read in Exodus 35. Moses is getting ready to put together the tabernacle and all the furnishings in the tabernacle. And he speaks to the congregation of the children of Israel in Exodus 35, verse 4, saying, "This is the thing which the Lord commanded me, saying," in verse 5, "Take from among you an offering to the Lord. Whoever is of a willing heart, let him bring it as an offering to the Lord, gold, silver, and bronze." And these verses go on to talk about all the supplies and all the things they need and all the artisans and all the knitters and quilters and everything else to make the tabernacle happen. Look at verse 21. "Then everyone came whose heart was stirred and everyone whose spirit was willing, and they brought the Lord's offering for the work of the tabernacle of meeting, for all its service and for the holy garments." Verse 24. "Everyone who offered an offering of silver or bronze brought the Lord's offering, and everyone with whom was found acacia wood and any work of the service brought it. All the women," in verse 25, "who were gifted artisans spun yarn with their hands and brought them, and they spun purple and scarlet and fine linen." And they were used. It's kind of like our interior team and our exterior teams. They were used of the Lord. Verse 29, "The children of Israel brought a freewill offering to the Lord. All the men and women whose hearts were willing brought material for all kinds of work which the Lord by the hand of Moses had commanded to be done." What a wonderful thing that happened there. Those people took of their possessions, which, by the way, most of which they had been given. Remember the story when they left Egypt? Where did they get all that gold and all that stuff? They were given it. God gave it to them from the Egyptians, just like everything we have. Look at verse 36. Let me cut to the chase. Look at chapter 36, verse 6. This is awesome. This is what it's all about, man. This is so cool. Moses gave a commandment in verse 6 of chapter 36. And caused it to be proclaimed throughout the camp, saying, "Let neither man nor woman do any more work for the offering of the sanctuary." And the people were restrained from bringing. That will not happen today during our offering, I can guarantee you that. But this is what happened there. "For the material they had was sufficient for all the work to be done. Indeed, too much." May that be so at Kingsland Baptist Church. And I believe it could be so. I believe that you will be better off, just as my family has been better off, in countless testimonies of men and women and teenagers and children that could tell you, "God has blessed me richly." Give sacrificially, knowing that it's the best money you'll ever spend. And God sees it and blesses it every single time, both in this life and the next. I thank God that at Kingsland we're not doing fundraisers down at the bank or at the gas station to try to pay our light bill. We don't do that. And we're not going to do that. We don't have to do that because God's people give cheerfully, generously, amazingly. Thank you, givers, for giving. If you're a giver, keep on giving. If you're not a giver, give. If you're a tither, keep on tithing. If you're not a tither, I would challenge you. Tithe. Put God to the test and see if he won't bless you in this day of grace, in this day of Christian liberty and freedom, far more than he did in the old covenant. Americans give more money to feed their dogs than supporting missionaries. That is a shame. Something must change. Only about 10% of Christians tithe. Something needs to change. And I can tell you, at Kingsland, it's a much higher percentage. Thank God. So the question in closing is this. What should you give? That's a fair question, isn't it? You don't have to agree with every single thing I'm saying to understand. You need to give. You need to find a church where you can give. Nothing? Something? A tithe? Less than a tithe? 11%, 12%, I don't know. What should you give? Take a moment to ask yourself this question and ask the Lord, what should I give? Ask Him that question. Lord, what do you want me to give? And by the way, lest I forget, the most important thing of all, give Jesus Christ your heart. Give Him your heart. He died for you. He was buried. He rose 3 days later. He paid a huge... Oh, praise the one who paid my debt. Awesome song. Jesus paid it all. Thank you for introducing that song today, Chris. I love that song. Jesus paid it all. Do you really think God is up? I almost said upstairs, but God's in heaven going, oh no, I can't pay my bills. What am I going to do? I sure hope those people at Kingsland will come through. I might fall off my throne if they don't give. No, He's just fine. He wants you to give so that He can trust you and give you more. So that you can be a blessing to others. He uses us. It's a principle. God always uses human beings. God uses people to bless people. And if you've not given your heart to Christ, you have yet to receive the free gift of salvation. You can't pay for it. You can't buy it. You just have to receive it. Repent of your sins. Invite Jesus Christ into your life right now. And He'll save you. If you've already, or you're already a sacrificial giver, just keep giving and trusting God's faithfulness. I invite you to take a minute right now to pray about your finances. Trusting God to provide for you. Pray over your tithes today, asking God to use your sacrifice in a miraculous way for you and your family and for your church family. Would you do that? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? We're going to have our invitation right now. I invite you to give your heart to Jesus and accept the free gift of salvation. If you want someone to pray with you about that, come and Pastor Derek will pray with you or I'll pray with you. If you're a giver, talk to the Lord about it. Ask Him to provide. We have not because we ask not. Keep giving. And I promise you, God will continue to be faithful. If you're not a tither, I would just ask you to talk to the Lord about that right now and ask Him what He wants you to do. Ask Him to speak to your heart. Ask Him to provide you with the courage and the faith and the resources to do what He wants you to do, not what I want you to do. You might want to just start by giving something. Give something. He'll reward that. Believe me, God's not up there with a big sovereign celestial fly swatter waiting to smack you because you don't do something. He loves you. He's your Father. He's going to provide for you. He's going to take care of you. You know, basically what He wants is for you to be like Him. Think about that. That's all God, and that's all we should want, is to worship Him, to glorify Him, and to be like Him. To be more like Him. You're never more like God than when you're giving. And boy, He gave it all, didn't He? He gave 100%. When I was doing that wedding last night, I was thinking about this day, this little sermon. And I thought, boy, you know, when we united those two in marriage, neither one of them said, you know, I'm going to give you 10%. You don't do that, do you? When you get married, you give all of yourself, and the other person gives all of themselves. The book of Ephesians chapter 5 talks about how in a mystical way we're married to Christ. He wants all of you. He wants 100% of you. Not 10%. He wants all of you. But we honor Him with the first fruit of our increase. With that 10%. And it's absolutely amazing. I can give personal testimony. It is absolutely astounding how much better you can live off 90%. Then you can off 100%. Well, that doesn't even make sense mathematically, does it? But it's true. If you're not a tither, just take time to talk to the Lord about it right now. You answer to Him. You're going to stand before Him one day, not me. Ask Him what He wants you to do. If you want someone to pray with, maybe you've lost your job this week, or you have a burden on your heart. Maybe you got a bad diagnosis this week, and you could really use just for a Pastor Derek or I, or maybe a deacon or a Sunday school teacher, or someone to pray for you. Take advantage of this invitation. Please don't stand. You don't have to sing. The worship team will sing. I would just ask that you'd remain in a spirit of prayer. And God, I just pray that you'd work in our hearts. I pray that you'd soften us up. Help us not to be prideful. Help us not to be easily offended. Lord, help us to just humble ourselves and to give you 100% of ourselves. Lord, I do pray for that one that is yet to be saved, yet to be born again. Lord, I pray they would come forward and receive the free gift of eternal life right now. And for those that are giving faithfully. Lord God, I pray that you would pour out the blessings on them. You said you'd open up the windows of heaven. You said that you would give and give and give, that we could press it down and shake it together, and you just keep giving to us. And Lord, thank you for how you've done that. But we don't want to take it for granted. Lord, help us to be more purposeful, methodical, and thoughtful in our giving. For those that are struggling with the tithe, Lord, I pray that you'd speak to their heart directly. And I pray that you would open their eyes and open their heart to what you want for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can stay in a spirit of prayer. God's working in your heart. Come forward. We'll pray with you.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love.
Let's stand.
There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne. Before the sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven.
Folks.
I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an the sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven.
Was at the men's conference yesterday, and in one of the sessions that we were in, the speaker made a comment that I'd never thought of. I had, but it brought it to mind. The pastor was talking about giving and what your giving does for the kingdom of God. The speaker said, he said, I have never looked into a set of eyes that God didn't love. Think about that. Think about that as you give. Let's pray. Father, we love you. And Lord, we do thank you. We thank you for your many blessings to us. But Lord, we thank you for your love for us. Lord, we ask that you would just open our hearts to you. Lord, open our hearts to your work and your will. Lord, help us to follow you in all that we do. Lord, help us to come before you and ask of you what you would have us do. Lord, use us. Use what we have because it belongs to you anyway. Lord, help us to be cheerful in giving to you. Lord, we thank you. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. We're singing,
shall it? If you've ever been on a trip with our youth group, you know that our youth group likes to sing, and sometimes it can get very annoying. Late at night, when they're screaming at the top of their lungs, we actually had a speaker for a camp that we did last year who came, and they started singing, and he was like, "Man," he said, "that brings back so many memories of when I was in the youth group, and I used to hate it when kids would sing." But then he goes, "You know," he said, "these people sound like a choir. This is some of the most beautiful singing I've ever heard." So, anyway. All right. Getting choked up here. I don't even know why. Proud of my little girls. All right. Anyway, I have a few quick announcements for you guys. If you need a t-shirt, you need to sign up for that today. Also, contrary to what the bulletin says, there are no Collision Ministry teams at noon. I'm not sure what the deal is with that. We thank you for coming. If you are visiting with us today, we thank you for coming. Our pastor would like to meet you, and he's actually at the end of the service going to be in the very back in the foyer. And what we would like from you, if you don't mind, is just to take a couple seconds to fill out the visitor card inside your bulletin and hand that to him. Say hey to him. He'd like to meet you. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this great time, and I thank you so much for the opportunity that we've had to study your word. And Lord, just for how much that you gave to us through your son, Jesus. And Lord, I pray that you would just bless our days today, Lord. Bless our services tonight. And I pray that we would keep you at the forefront of our mind and what you've done for us and everything we do. In your name I pray. Amen.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordalise. I'm the pastor right here at Kingsland Baptist Church in Chesterfield County. I want to thank you for connecting with us tonight. And our television show is called Connecting at Kingsland. And the reason for that is based on our motto, and that is connecting people with Christ. That's why we exist. We want to help you get connected with your Creator. And tonight, maybe you were inspired or you were touched to do that. And you realize you need a relationship with Jesus Christ, I would encourage you to give your heart to Jesus. Get down on your knees right now and repent of your sins. Ask God to forgive you for your sins. And invite the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart and save you. He loves you. None of us can work our way to heaven. The Bible is very clear about that. Ephesians 2:8 says that you're saved by grace through faith. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man could boast. So salvation is a free gift that the Lord offers you for the taking, and He wants to connect with you. And so do we here at Kingsland. If you'd like more information about our church, just go to the web, kingslandbaptist.com. Or you can call us if you have questions about anything, if you need help, if you need someone to talk to, if you have a prayer request, 275-1285. Call us anytime, and we'll help you as best we can. You're invited to come worship with us any Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. You would be our honored guest, and we'd love to have you here. And once again, tune in with us next Friday night at 6 o'clock for Connecting at Kingsland right here on Comcast 17. God bless you.
heavens by surprise. A holy nation sanctified.